essentially the international business, Europe, Middle East, Africa, Asia Pacific, Australia, New Zealand. Delighted to be here in your beautiful country and this amazing city. Thank you so much for inviting me here. It's a real pleasure and a privilege to be here. I was asked to talk for sort of 15 minutes or so about innovation and the innovation that Uber can bring, and in particular, how that can particularly help building the Spanish cities of the future. So that's what I'm going to try and do. If I can get the clicker to work. There we go. So maybe what I thought I would do is just start with talking a little bit about Uber. I mean, some of you probably know a little bit about Uber. Maybe others of you don't. So Uber's really started since 2009. And it really was inspired, actually, I'm proud to say, it was actually inspired by Europe. It was based on these two gentlemen here who were actually at a conference not dissimilar to this in Paris back in 2009. And as you can see behind them is the Eiffel Tower. And they were, after the conference, struggling to get a ride home. It's not that there aren't cars or taxis available in Paris, it's just there weren't any available for them at that time. So the one turns to the other and goes, hey, you know, wouldn't it be really awesome if I could just take out my phone, press a button, and a car would arrive in 5 minutes? And they thought about that, and they thought, hey, that's actually quite a nice idea, as many of these businesses are actually based on a really simple idea. And that's exactly what they did. What you see today is really the result of that conversation back in Paris in 2009. And you know, those of you who've used Uber will be familiar with these screens. Essentially what you do is exactly that. You put out your iPhone, the technology detects where you are and where the closest car is. It tells you how many minutes it'll be until that car is available to pick you up. You press, yes, I'd like to have a ride. The driver will come and pick you up from that location. And as you'll see at the bottom left, you'll see a picture of the guy who's going to come and pick you up. And you'll see the license plate of the car that's going to come and get you, which is really important because, you know, increasingly in this day and age, we want safety and reliability, particularly for women. And then what you can do is you can either just tell the driver where you want to go, or you can actually just type in your destination so that he can get mapping and tell himself where he needs to go. And then finally, at the end of your trip, you'll get a little receipt at the end, as you can see there on the right, in this case for €3, and you'll rate the driver between 1 star and 5 stars. That's really important because it allows us to give feedback directly to the driver, maintain the quality, and in many cases, if we're not keeping that quality bar up, we'll have a conversation with the drivers just to let him know how he's doing. And it's as simple as that. That's how it works. Everything is cashless. So there's no need to get money out of your pocket or tip people. Your card or your PayPal is all linked into your account, and you're done. That's how it works. Oh, that's a bit of a preview. Let's see if we can go back here. Sorry about that. What actually happens, and this is actually, it starts very small. In any city that we go into, and you know, the video said 212, it's actually 230 cities worldwide that we're operating in now, three here in Spain, Madrid, Barcelona, and Valencia. And what happens is it starts very small. So here you'll see a picture of actually one Friday night in San Francisco when it first started. And literally, this is from an internal tool that we have, and you can see the number of cars there that are going around San Francisco in this. So the guys got very excited by this. They thought this was amazing because they had like 10 cars on the road and they thought, wow, this could really be something. What actually happens then? Okay. Sorry about that. What actually happens then is, and here's a picture of Paris yesterday, you'll see that over time you get a lot more liquidity into the system. You get a lot more people asking for rides and a lot more people providing cars to offer those rides. And you get a bunch of choice. You get an Uber Pop, which is a person-to-person ride-sharing service. You get UberX, Uber Berlin, Uber Van. There are different options around each of the different cities that we go into. But essentially what we're doing is we're providing choice and making that market really efficient so that people can get a ride in a quick amount of time. I'm sure I'm only pressing it once. Okay. You're gonna know what I'm gonna say ahead of everything. So. What happens, though, is at scale, it goes from that picture I just showed you of Paris to this is like 2 days ago in New York, and those of you will be able to recognize the Manhattan Island there, and you get pretty dense coverage of cars there. And you'll notice that there's all different colored cars there. That's because we offer all of those different kinds of services, including yellow taxis in this case in New York, which is one of our biggest cities. Okay, let's try. Maybe it wasn't. And what happens then is once you get that density, you get really, really quick pickup times. And here's some of the times that we have going around the world. You know, San Francisco, you're waiting for about just over 2.5 minutes on average for a car. In New York, you know, very similar. In London, we're just over 3 minutes. Even in Barcelona, where we're still pretty early stages, it's about 6 minutes. And that's what happens is when you get that density of people asking for and people providing rides, you get a super efficient transportation system, and that's what we're trying to do. So it's no different here in Spain, and what you'll see on this chart is how the first 200 days in some of our largest cities around the world have progressed. And you can see London, San Francisco, and Paris down there. They've gone pretty well. We're delighted with the performance of those cities, and the response we get from riders in those cities has been amazing. What is really interesting, though, is when you look here at Spain, what has happened. Look at Barcelona. Barcelona has been 3.5 times bigger in that same period of time than those other monster cities. And Madrid, which we only launched in September, is going even faster. So we're quite amazed by Spain. We think that there's a huge demand here. There's a huge opportunity, and basically people are asking for a more efficient, more reliable, safer transportation system than they have today. So we already have tens of thousands of riders in Spain. We have thousands of drivers signed up to the platform already. We've done tens of thousands of trips. And I think one thing that's perhaps a little different about us compared to other, you know, large tech companies around the world is that whilst we're using global technology, we're having very specific local impact. We have teams on the ground in every city that we operate in, and all of the revenue that's generated from our system, minus our commissions, coming back into the local community. So it's global technology, but it has really local impact. Guys, I don't know if you can just maybe fast forward, do the slides for me rather than me clicking this thing because it's a bit sensitive. Is that possible?
Yeah.
Okay. So here's what we've seen in the last 6 months in Spain. We did 10x in the first 3 months. In the next 3 months, we did 3x. And in the next 3 months, we expect to do 4 times that growth. And that's based on what we've seen in other cities and the enormous demand that we've seen here in Spain. And the way we do that is via a product called UberPop. And I want to explain to you the impact that UberPop is making. So this is a picture that you're probably familiar with. This is a route into Madrid one day. You can tell by the bus saying into Madrid. And, you know, it's a sight that we see commonly around lots of cities, right, which is congested roads. If you look at the number of cars that are in Madrid and Barcelona, just those two cities, there are 2.4 million cars, private cars, cars coming into those cities every day. And that's emitting 4.3 million tons of CO2 annually into those cities. On average, we're wasting, each of us, 55 hours in traffic by sitting around in congestion. And the average car is only actually used for 5% of the time each year. So what we think about is a world where you can imagine moving from the left-hand side here of lots and lots of cars, like that picture I showed you of coming into Madrid, into a world where we have fewer cars, but they're used simultaneously. Okay, so on the left-hand side, people are driving on their own in many cases. On the right-hand side, they're sharing cars. And this creates enormous efficiency. So on the top, you'll see here, on average, this is from data in Spain, that, you know, there are 1.3 passengers on average in a car in Spain, and they're doing about 1.6 trips per day. So they're doing 2-person trips per day. Now, in our In our Uber Pop system, where people are sharing cars, there are about 2.3 people on average, and they're doing 5.4 trips per day, i.e. 8-person trips, which is 4 times more efficient. The other interesting thing is that when we talked to the Spanish population, TNS did a survey of over 10 cities across Spain in September, and what we found was pretty interesting, was that 92% of people in Spain wanted access to more convenient and affordable alternatives than they currently had. And 3/4 of them, 75% of people, said that they would use ride sharing either as riders or drivers. This is as high as anywhere we've seen anywhere in the world. And when we talked to our own users on the right-hand side, the Uber Pop survey, we found that 50%, more than 50% of those users have used it instead of their private car at some point. So it's an alternative to using their private car. And they do see it, 89% of people see it as an alternative rather than a full substitution. So really what we're doing is we're adding another alternative into the ecosystem of transportation around countries. So I just want to explain a little bit then what Uber Pop is. What Uber Pop is really it's a person-to-person ride-sharing service that allows the owner of that car to share the costs of fuel and maintenance and parking of operating that car. And in doing so, it provides extra transportation opportunities to people who want to ride. And when you look at the costs of owning your own car versus actually sharing a car, it's quite interesting. It turns out that it's actually cheaper. And so on the left-hand side here, what we've done is we've pulled together the stats of actually owning a car in Spain. And this is the average across the whole of Spain. You can see how it breaks down. And then when you compare it to doing 45 rides a month, which is the 1.5 average a day that people are doing here in Spain, it turns out that it's about 18% cheaper to use a service such as that than owning your own car. The other impact it has, and this is a picture of Chicago, where we see that it provides mobility not just in the city, but across the city. And what you can see here in this picture is that the density of rides is happening within the city, but in the light blue area, you can see that 40% of trips are starting or ending in underserved areas. Underserved meaning they don't have good public transportation links. So whilst it starts in the middle, it very quickly spreads out and provides alternative transportation to people who might otherwise have trouble getting a ride. The other thing that is really interesting, because it can provide a much cheaper alternative, is that we see that small businesses who are, you know, really, in my opinion, the lifeblood of an economy, are using this, are really engaging with. And in Chicago, again, we see that 1 in 3 trips is starting or ending with small businesses. Again, so something that small businesses are finding super useful. And we also see that it has benefits of safety. I mentioned the taxi photo, I mentioned the license plate, and that, and everything, of course, is tracked. So in terms of, you know, feeling safe, and we see this a lot from women riders in particular. You know, my wife is always traveling around London, feeling a little bit nervous about getting cars late at night because she didn't know who she was getting into the car with. And now she feels that she can open up her app and know who the driver is. She can see the license plate, and she knows that everything is going to be recorded. She feels much safer. But in addition to that, we see in places such as Seattle that DUI, which is driving under the influence, people drinking too much and then driving, the incidence of that dropped by 10% in the year after Uber launched there. We also saw that taxi crime dropped by 20% in Chicago in the year afterwards. Because if you think about it, people are not, you know, taxi drivers are not carrying around a lot of cash. Everything is cashless, so there's no reason to go in and, you know, beat up the taxi driver and try and steal his cash. And I traveled with a guy in San Francisco a couple of weeks ago who told me that was the sole reason he had moved over from driving his taxi on a particular platform to driving on the Uber platform, because he had been beaten up and he didn't want that to happen again, and everything was cashless. So there's a safety element there that is extremely important. So that's kind of where we got to right now, but I'd like to sort of pitch to you a little bit more about where this could go, right? I mean, I think it already has enormous impact, but I think there's an extra stage that we could take it to, and I think it can have a huge impact here in Spain. Imagine a world which we call Uber Pool, where it's, rather than me jumping in a car and getting out, and then the driver going to get another person and getting out, it kind of in series, it happened in parallel. So in this scenario, you see car picking up one passenger, then he picks up a second passenger, then he drops off the first passenger, maybe he picks up a third passenger, and drops off the second passenger, et cetera, et cetera. You get the idea. So there's parts of the journey that have multiple people in that, all kind of going in the same direction, so it's super efficient, and reducing the cost to those people who are traveling together. In the same way that if you were in a bus or a tram or a train or whatever, you don't travel individually, you travel in parallel with others. So imagine that world. And what we see is those same stats I gave you earlier will now put on the bottom four passengers on average, doing the same number of trips per day, gives you a much larger number of person trips per day. In fact, it's 8 times more efficient than us all using our private vehicles, driving into Madrid or Barcelona, wherever it happens to be, 8 times more efficient. And then when you look at the numbers again in terms of whether it's cost effective to do it, then it starts to become really interesting. Rather than the 18% reduction I showed you before, now we're into a world where it's significantly cheaper and actually makes a lot of economic sense. Again, based on the same number of trips that people are doing on average around their cities, it becomes very much more cheap for somebody to do this. And then when you look at let's aggregate this all up together, and you see that there's 2.4 million cars, as I said, in Madrid and Barcelona together, which is doing every day 4.7 million trips per day. Well, if you just shared those cars like in the Uber Pop world, then you only need 650,000 cars instead of that 2.4 million. And then if you pooled people as well, i.e. they rode together, then you only need 300,000 cars to do the same number of person trips per day, i.e. 2 million less cars. Okay, that's kind of interesting. Now, you might say, well, I don't think everybody's going to do that. And you're probably right, I don't think everybody will do that. But let's think, well, what if we just said, how about 500,000 cars off the roads of Madrid and Barcelona going into the city every day? What would it take to do that? Well, the answer actually, I think, is not that unbelievable, which is that you get people willing to pool and share, and you create 65,000 extra jobs. That's what it takes. People willing to do it, and a bunch more jobs. Okay, that sounds reasonable to me. So, what I'd like you to kind of imagine is, what would Spain be like? What would it take in Spain for that kind of thing to happen? And really, what I think it takes is just this. You get Spanish users interested in ride sharing, which I've already shown you by surveying the population, TNS showed us they already were. 92% of people wanting it, 75% of people prepared to use ride sharing. We've got vehicle owners who would be interested in sharing their cars. Again, from the surveys we know that's true, and from our own data we know that we've got huge demand for people willing to drive. So we've got both of those two things are kind of a tick. And then what we need is ride sharing regulation that fosters a new economic activity. I should just pause at this point to say that there are already principles under the Spanish laws and legislation that allow cost sharing, and that's the framework in which we operate. But in addition, there's starting to be leadership shown by progressive cities, such as in Barcelona. The government of Catalonia have established a new committee for the collaborative economy, looking at this, and they're showing real leadership in looking at these issues and taking them forward, so I commend that. But I think it's fair to say that the regulation is not perfectly set up yet, and why would it be? Because in many cases, transportation regulation has been written many years ago, even before smartphones even existed, so it's not perfectly designed for new technology just yet. But I think that if you look at the most progressive cities around the world, and many of these, many examples actually around the world already, including in California and Washington DC, where people have embraced this, put in place new legislation and allowed this to happen, already seeing massive benefits into their cities. So I think that's the one missing piece where I think it's starting to happen. As I said, the principle exists. Various provincial governments are looking at this stuff to try and move it forward. And if we get that, then what the result is that we get better mobility around the cities. We get much more self-employment. We're creating 50,000 jobs a month on the Uber platform right now, and there's no reason why we shouldn't have a similar kind of impact on Spain, and I think That would be a good thing for Spain. And of course, there's the impact on the economy as well, with fewer costs of congestion, much less wasted time, less CO2 coming into our cities. So that's what I'd like to leave you with, a world where Uber, it'd like to be part of that. We're not the only ones. I think there are other people that can play in that space as well. We know that we're offering a good service to riders to give them a convenient, safe, affordable ride in less than 5 minutes. We know that we've got demand from drivers in terms of creating potential new economic opportunities for them to create their own little business. And I think there's also a third one that we often forget, which is the impact on cities and on smart cities and the Spanish cities of the future. So I'd like to leave you with that image of imagining 500,000 fewer cars in the cities of Madrid and Barcelona. Thank you.
Tenemos tiempo para preguntas. Supongo que habrá preguntas para Uber. Si no tenéis que levantar la mano, que yo vea que hay uno por allí, la primera.
Thank you very much for your presentation. Don't you think it's just a bit misleading sometimes to call Uber ride sharing? You always insist on the sharing concept, but at the end of the day, it's just a driver delivering a professional service to passengers, which is more efficient and can be great, but it doesn't differ from real ride sharing represented in Spain, for example, by companies such as BlaBlaCar or Movens, in which people really share cars to go from point A to point B. And in that respect, your stats showed that in a normal ride, you had an average of 1.3 people, whereas in an Uber ride, you had 2.3, but it said including the driver. So if you remove the driver that wouldn't have performed the ride otherwise, then it would be 1.3 versus 1.3. Thank you.
Okay, great, thanks for the question. First thing to say on that is we're not the only people trying to offer innovative mobility systems around the world, and frankly, I commend anybody who's trying to do this. I think there are a bunch of other great companies who are trying to do good stuff, and good luck to them. I think it's genuinely good for choice and the consumer and cities and all of the things I said. So I don't want to give the impression we're the only guys trying to do something interesting here. So first point, in terms of the ride sharing, yeah, in different cities around the world, as I showed in my presentation, we have a lot of different services. We have taxis in New York, we have limousine drivers under a professional license in different cities as well, New York being a good example, or London. But we also have cost sharing or ride sharing, depending on what you want to call it. What we see actually is that is the fastest growing part of our business. It's the one that people like the best, really, because it actually is the most affordable. And it allows people to share the costs of owning and operating their car. And that's the principle under which we're operating here in Spain. As I said, as the regulations develop here in Spain, I think we'll probably introduce other services here as well. BlaBlaCar and people like that, of course, they have a slightly different model. Those are all good models, I think. In our particular case, we're focused on cities and the density that is required in each of the cities, and that's where the majority of the rides are happening. But the principle is that people are simply here in Spain able to cover the costs of owning and operating their car. That's what we think. For me, it's less about the destination of where they're going. It's more about can they share the costs of operating their car. And in terms of the stats that you say in there, even with the driver included in that, then it's four times more efficient. So it doesn't really matter so much. The point is that each of these things are multiples more efficient than an individual driving on his own or with a 0.3 person extra in his car, sharing cars, whether it's in taxis or in a BlaBlaCar scenario or in an Uber scenario, is generally a good thing. It's a more efficient thing.
Creo que había una por aquí. Micrófono aquí, por favor. ¿Hay alguna más? Aparte. Vale.
Good morning, Mr. Wass. The Catalan Parliament has decided today to block any driver of Uber in the city of Barcelona and to give a fine of 6,000 euro to any of them if they are captured by police. What do you think about that? You think it's going to spread around other cities in Europe?
I haven't seen that particular extra news today.
It's been this very morning, today.
Okay. As I said, generally here in Spain, we're operating under the principles of cost sharing that exist in the Spanish legislation right now, which allow people to share their car and cover the cost of doing that. I think it's fair to say, though, that yes, we have seen that kind of reaction in different people, because people have different interpretation of what those laws mean. Our interpretation is that that is something that we can operate in. And of course, we're innovating within that framework. But as I said, I think that most progressive cities around the world are looking at their current regulations and saying, okay, is this a good thing? And generally, most people are going, this is good for people, it's good for drivers, and it's good for the city, and therefore it's time to update our legislation. So for example, as I said, if you look in places, mostly in the US right now, to be fair, you'll see that they have introduced new things called TNC licenses, Transport Network Companies, and they have a TNC license, which allows ride-sharing to be embedded fully within the framework of the law. It requires a certain number of things like checks on the cars, a certain level of insurance, those kind of things. And so what I think you'll see is that most cities that are progressive will look at that and they will over time adopt that. But you're right, there'll be a teething trouble, if you like, on the way to that. And as I said, most of these legislations were written before smartphones even existed, so it's not fair to say they're wrong because they couldn't have predicted this would happen.
So. And secondly, do you have a commitment? Are you compromised to defend legally the Uber drivers that could be fined if they drive with your application?
Yeah, I mean, you know, the people who are on our platform, the drivers in particular, are fundamental to our platform. So we are their biggest fans, and we will do whatever we can to support them.
So any Uber driver is going to pay a fine for doing Uber activity?
Well, as I said, you know, I can't go into the specific details of every case because I'm not familiar with most of them. But we will do whatever we can to support them, including provide them legal assistance and various other things. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Following the same questions, since you've been managing your company in different cities that are progressive, can you help the government of the Basque country or the Catalonian country understand how can they change their regulation to be able to admit sharing activities like this? I mean, you do have a lot of information that before opening up your service, you can provide the government so they can understand better when to provide.
Yeah, if I understood your question correctly, is can we and should we provide information to governments to help them understand what we're doing and
exactly. Benefits?
Yes. Yes, we can and we do. And we're extremely open about engaging with anybody who would like to discuss this. As I said, you know, Catalonia has already established a committee to look at this, and that's, I think, a sensible way to go. And in many cases, we try and provide information and, you know, explanations such as the one I've given today about what we're trying to do and why. And you know, even beyond that, you know, what we're trying to do now is show people, here's legislation that has actually been put in place by other cities. You can take it, you can adapt it to things that make most sense for your local situation. And we've actually had a lot of governments around the world saying that's extremely helpful because they don't want to have to reinvent the wheel the whole time. They can take it and they can move on. So that is happening a lot. And, you know, we're open-minded to anybody who wants to engage with us and share that kind of information.
You're facing considerable resistance, particularly in continental Europe and some parts of continental Europe, and also interesting to watch the mounting negative PR. I have two questions. Is this a specific Europe issue and, you know, the environment in Europe? And two, what is your strategy to refocus your PR communication marketing strategy to overcome these barriers in Europe?
Yeah, thank you. Good question. I'd like to turn it back to you. Do you think it's a specific Europe issue?
I do think there's some elements of that in it.
In what respect?
Because it's got to do with the thinking in Europe and a certain conservative attitude towards the disruption of existing business models, and I think it's going to be to do with fears in Europe, but I'd like to hear your point of view.
Yeah, look, I generally agree with you. I think as a European, I'm sometimes dismayed by the conservative nature of the way we embrace new technologies, in particular across Europe. It, frankly, it saddens me a bit because there's so many amazing businesses being created in other parts of the world and we seem a bit close to it sometimes. And that's just my personal opinion. And so I do think you're right. I think it is a bit more conservative in Europe. Having said that, you know, once we've taken a little bit more time to engage with people and explain to them, such as the gentleman was asking there, we do see people actually warming up and understanding that it can have huge benefits for their citizens, creating jobs, and for their cities, reducing cars. And then it maybe just take you a little bit longer here in Europe. In terms of the PR and how we deal with that, I think, you know, again, very fair question. I think we have, as any company that has come up with a new idea and grown very fast and been, you know, reasonably successful, people want to have a look at it and inspect it and see how it's operating and see what challenges it has. And, you know, I don't think we've always come off amazingly in our PR. I think we could be a bit more humble in terms of the way we explain ourselves and what we're trying to do. And sometimes perhaps we come across as a bit too aggressive. And I think what you would like to do is not to do that and just to explain the benefits that we can bring to riders, drivers, and cities. And so I think we'll try to, you know, give that kind of better explanation about benefits than perhaps we have done in the past.
No hay más equivocadas las preguntas. Simplemente antes de acabar, bueno, te dejo la última, venga, pregunta la última que estás ahí. ¿Me has levantado la mano antes?
How did you cover the possibility that the driver during the trip has an accident? And maybe the client makes a demand to the driver because there is a death, I don't know. Whatever. Yeah. How do you cover this? You ask the driver to have a full insurance or?
Yeah, I mean, it's a great question. I mean, it's often one that gets asked about what's the safety of doing this, and safety is not just, you know who the driver is, it's also about insurance, right? And so, you know, it differs around the world, but generally the way it works on the ride-sharing part of our business is that people have their own private insurance for that car, and over and above that, we have our own top-up insurance, which stands to the tune of 3.9 million euros per incident, that we provide as Uber, in case there's no coverage from that private insurance. So that's how we deal with it. There's two kind of coverages for that. Where it goes in the future is in other places around the world. Like I explained in California, what they've done is they've insisted a minimum of $1 million insurance per incident, and that's part of the legislation. So we're doing it voluntarily right now. I think where it goes in the future is that actually that will be demanded as part of the regulatory framework.
Terminamos aquí. Simplemente antes de acabar, quiero decir una cosa. Quiero felicitar a la ciudad de Bilbao, a sus políticos, incluso a colectivos de taxis, que como podéis imaginar estamos sensibilizados con este tema, porque bueno, el debate se ha producido sin ningún problema. El debate, como veis, ha sido limpio, transparente, que es lo que pretendíamos. Sinceramente tengo mis dudas de que pudiésemos llevar a cabo este debate sin problemas en otras ciudades. Creo que hay otras ciudades que deben aprender la tolerancia de esta. En este sentido, a pesar, insisto, de que es un tema muy sensible y de que hay colectivos muy afectados. Muchas gracias.